Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Thank you so much for joining us today. Right, if you could hear us and see us, okay? I do have some feedback.
Thank you so much.
Do you have a tab pulled up?
Okay, honey. I do have some feedback. Thank you so much. Do you have
let's wait for the feedback to go away.
That's why. I'm sorry.
It's okay. It's that's cool. That totally is cool. It happens. And so yeah, if you could hear us, so if you could hear us and see us, okay. I think it's okay now. Let's see some llamas in the chat. I think I do hear some llamas in the chat. Hi, Bonnie. Hey, Meg. John, May Lady, Beth. Hello. Someone says it's 6 p.m. in the evening. Time for some painting. That's awesome. Kim, Sandra, Karine, Inos. All right. So I think we could begin. So hello, everybody. I'm Kathleen with Etchr Studio. I'll be your studio host for today. We are an art learning platform who works with art teachers from all over the world. And today's free demo is actually brought to you by Jared Cullum. And this works as a preview actually for his 90-minute class. So the class will be on March 11th, 2 p.m. Eastern time. And Jared will be talking about a comprehensive study of the fundamentals of portraits. And with that said, Jared, could you let us know what we'll be doing today and how that connects with your Etchr class?
Sure. I guess first off, I should say I'm Jared Cullum. My main day job is in kids' books and young adult book writing and illustrating, which is much more cartoony than my kind of traditional work. I do have a channel on YouTube, though, that teaches traditional media, so teaching mostly gouache, because that's what I get more questions about than anything. But I do portraits, I do landscapes and watercolor. And I'm just very passionate about watercolor, and I carry it with me everywhere. And one of the things I'm very passionate about is sketching people on location. So I don't have a ton of examples because I typically will give them to the person I'm sketching, but I love sketching portraits on location. If you're going out to coffee or you're going out, you know, anywhere you can sit down, even on the couch with your spouse or your kid, it's always nice to have the sketchbook handy so you can block in a basic portrait. So with that said, today I want to take a look at some of the basics of just laying in the head and getting some of those basic forms down and planes and following those forms to block in a head quickly and efficiently. And then later on in the 90-minute class, I'd like to elaborate more on those specific shapes and how they interlock with one another. Portraiture is its own sort of complex universe. You kind of can't dip your toe in it. It's really something that takes a lot of time to study, but yeah. It's also very enjoyable if you can just allow yourself, like a lot of things with art, to just enjoy the process. Technical proficiency, that kind of thing, comes in time with practice. So I just want to talk about ways that we can, what I focus on and what I focus on my channel, Jared Loves to Draw, is I try to focus on teaching people to learn, to make art, and not just necessarily to make art immediately, which is hard. You have to balance the fact that people want to be satisfied by making something very quickly. But what I like is for people to understand form, understand the science of light, how those things interact with one another, so that as you grow, you can glean that knowledge. When you're sketching someone, you go, oh yeah, I see how that shape interlocks with another. But that's what I'd like to talk about. We can jump over to the desk.
Yeah, please do. I think they would love to see some of your works and your 90-minute class sample. Yeah.
Okay, you're on the desk.
Great.
Okay, great. I didn't lose you, did I?
Yeah. No, you're okay, good. Great.
Good, and I can hear you, and I've got hot tea.
Wow, that's a perfect compliment.
I will probably mute here and there because we're trying to go a little bit quick here today because of the time limit. So I will be using the hairdryer quite a bit. So some examples of my work. As I said, my main work that I do, the main thing I make a living on is working in young adult books. And this is an example of that kind of thing. Portraiture is important to me because I use all the same kind of knowledge and skill sets that you study and try to build on in portraiture and doing portraits on location as I do drawing cartoons. Even though most of what I draw for my day job is cartoons, I focus a lot on the basics of portraiture, which is what we'll talk a lot about today.
Yeah, great.
So some
just a lot of, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, some examples of the work, you know, I basically follow my poor wife everywhere with my sketching supplies. So this was just her working. This was a self-portrait I did for my YouTube channel, but all the same basic principles. This I wanted to mention because this is a test run for the 90-minute class. So today we're going to be working with a very single light source, strong light source on a portrait. This one's a little more complicated as it's two light sources. So it becomes more of a study of the forms and the shapes and how they sort of interlock with one another. And here's just another quick sketch of my wife on the couch watching a movie or something.
All right. And just to let everybody know, by watching or purchasing Jared's content, you'll be directly contributing to how much he makes. So please consider having a look at his class, which I just posted in a link. And before we begin, just a few reminders for everybody. If you have any questions, type them in all caps, just like this in the chat. And we have a private Facebook group, which you could join. It's open to anyone making art related to both our free content and paid classes. And keep an eye on the chat because I'll be posting a lot of links there, including Jared's reference photos and outline sketches. So Jared, go ahead and take it away.
All right. So I'm going to try to keep it a little bit small because I want to still be able to make some marks on it for examples of things that I want to talk about. First, and if you watch my videos, you'll hear me say it over and over again, and I talk about it a lot, is we want to go broad to basic. So first, I just want to basically, I'm trying to map out my silhouette here of what I'm looking at. So I'm not concerned about like the way that the forehead and the eyebrow overlap quite yet. I just want to make sure that I'm getting these forms in, kind of map out where everything is. So we got an ear here. Once you start mapping locations of things on your portrait, you can start to find through lines of where things are. So if I take from the bottom of this ear here and I go across, I see that hits the nose. So that's going to give me a location for where the nose will be. This way. We have this nice cast shadow of the hair. Another great technique for finding the locations of things is we can always measure using our pencil. So if you hold your pencil, you find a measurement, say like the back of the hair to the cast shadow, and I put it in, I see that takes me to where the nose is. So that will give me a location of where the inside of that socket of the nose is. I want to be aware of the fact that there is this wedge here. The eyes go deeper in. So there's light here. I don't want to miss. The eye comes in. And we want to remember that the eye is an eyeball. And be aware of where our camera is when we're sketching the eye. So the eye is a ball. And in perspective, because our camera is pretty close to level with the top eyelid, it's going to be straighter and the bottom is going to be more curved. Where if our camera was lower, then the bottom might be more straight and the top might have more curve to it. So we're looking at this right now. And most of the eye, we're not really even going to be concerned with. The biggest concern I think you want to be aware of when you're drawing the eyes is not, or the nose, is that our brain has a funny way of, when we think something is important, we will make it extra big. So a lot of times people painting landscapes will make the cars like extra huge or something, because, or windows is a really bad one. People will accidentally make the windows like gigantic because you see the thing as important. And so your brain makes you want to make it bigger. So we want to make sure that the eyes are not too big. Most of the eye we're not going to even see because it's going to be lost to shadow. So we've got this shadow coming down. I'm going to start thinking about how the shadow is wrapping around these forms. Yeah, shadow.
And Jared, sorry to interrupt you. I know this looks great, and would we be able to get the lines just a little bit darker for demonstration purposes
only? Oh, sure, sure. I actually usually draw with a red pencil.
Uh huh.
But for this demo's sake, I was trying to go with a darker pencil.
I see.
Part of what I'm doing is drawing fairly light on purpose because I don't necessarily want to tie it down yet because I might want to move some things. But now that I've started to get some placement of some of these things, I'm going to start. So, you know, we've got this curve here, so I can start to consider the complexity. You just don't want to get too carried away. A lot of that will handle with the paint. So we can start tying some of this down. The eyebrow, we want to remember it wraps over. There's like a sinus cavity here in the skull. It wraps up and over. And the back you don't see much of. So our main focus is watching how this wraps. Just like the eye, where we focus on the fact that it's a ball, we want to focus on the fact that the mouth is also sitting on a ball. It's just placed in. So we have underneath it this little bit of value. There's a ball on the chin here. And then move up. And because he has a mustache, it's going to create a kind of form on top here. And we can follow our guides too. We go from the inside of the eye down, we'll find our nose, the inside of the, where the pupil is. If you go down, it's going to be about where the mouth approximates. But we want to remember that the mouth is on a, like the inside of a ball or like a hockey puck or a tuna can, whatever you use to imagine. So it's going to go out and then back in. Over on this side. And a lot of this is going to be in shadow, so it's not going to be terribly important. Part of what you want to do too is consider how your edges and things communicate what's important. So a lot of these areas are going to be softer anyways. We follow the mouth over here. We got this. The nose, we want to make sure, I mean the nose, the ear, coming off the ear, we want to make sure we're getting this, there's a muscle there called the sternocleidomastoid. That's that big one. It goes down from the ear and connects right here. So I don't want to be too specific because portraiture is all about subtlety. And anytime you try to do anything kind of ham-fisted to communicate an idea in portraiture, it immediately can get away from you and take away from the overall portrait. So I need to bring his jaw in a little more. And I want to make sure that our neck, because of that sternocleidomastoid, it's going to roll and kind of fold into the neck, the collar of the neck here. Okay, so I think that's about enough information. I'm noticing now that this looks, I've gone out too far, so I'm going to come in a little bit. Could handle this with the paint. It's not as important. But that's our basic kind of drawing to get in the main things. You know, he's got hair on the backside too, which is a good dark value, which is nice. You always want, it's important to have lights and darks that play against one another. All value when you're sketching and painting is relative. So we'll get into that when we start placing things down. But things appear light because there's dark contrasting it. They appear dark because there's light contrasting it. So I'm gonna just wet up the box. Get a paper towel handy, and I'm going to start laying in some color here. It may not be specifically accurate, but a lot of that you can adjust with the paint. The paint, watercolor is much more forgiving than people give it credit for.
Yeah. And Jared, did you just spray on water on a paper with that tool you used?
I misted the paint box. You could totally spray or wet the whole area. That wouldn't be a bad idea to make sure your colors are soft.
Great. Okay.
I'm using fairly large brushes. I always recommend using large brushes. This is a number 6. It might be 12 millimeters. Also want to say thanks to the YouTube channel Love Life Drawing because they gave me the reference photo to use today. So just a note about portraits in general, I'm going to start laying in things and I want to make sure that I keep things relatively high in key, which means the brightness and saturation of the color. I'm not going to go this ham-fisted, but I'm keeping this in mind, which is that the head, we've got three main zones of the face. So as I go about painting the portrait, this is something that you gather more from painting from life. When you paint from a photograph, it tends to crunch the color character. So you lose a lot of that subtlety. So if you can keep this in mind, that the face is broken into zones. Again, this is ham-fisted, but I'm just trying to make a point. You can see what I'm doing right. So this is just to show you, usually the top of the head is kind of facing closer to the light source. So it's going to be a little bit more yellow ochre. The middle of the face tends to be redder because you have a lot of blood in the cheeks and in the nose and in the ear and a lot of subsurface scatter, which is something I'm going to talk a lot about in the 90-minute version where we have a little more time to dig into surface materials, which is another huge thing that I'm very interested in, which is how do we treat the flesh different from a shirt or the hair? How does subsurface scatter create this kind of glow, and how can we kind of chase after that? So we'll talk a little bit about that when we're applying the paint, but really that's going to be its own thing I'm going to have to talk about in the 90 minute. So first layer down, we want to just knock out the white. There's not really any white, and if there was white, I'm not against just using some white gouache on top. So the first brush stroke is extremely important that you don't mess it up, and it's very precise. I'm just kidding. It doesn't matter. I'm going very watery here. So we're going maybe 90% water. So a lot of this, what I'm doing is going to be close to white. So it's not that important. It's just knocking down the white of the page, because the white is way strong. And if you end up trying to piece it together, you run the risk of having little white gaps. And when you have little white gaps in a portrait, so I'm just going to, just a note, use a little bit of blue in that mix to just cool this down. So again, not icy blue cold. And you'll notice I don't really care about rolling over the hair. I'm just putting down a light value. And remember that we're layering, and so a lot of these later, subsequent layers will be darker values. So they will cover up a lot of this anyways. So we just want to get in our light value and get rid of the white. If you have a cool light source, it's a good chance to set that up, getting some of that. You know, I can place in a little bit of cools here. Always making sure between putting the brush down, I'm dabbing on a paper towel, especially if you're using something like this brush, which is a very water retentive brush. It holds a lot of water in it. So you want to make sure you're getting rid of excess water, because anytime you place a brush onto wet paint, it's going to shoot water out. So in doing that, you know, if you've got a wet area, it's going to immediately flood the area and cause burns. I don't really care about those. I find just in teaching watercolor, people get really upset about a lot of little things with watercolor. If you'll notice, I'm a little bit like ham-fisted with it because I've gotten comfortable in the material. So I'm noticing the background is kind of cool. So I want to create this sort of greenish background by using, I've got yellow ochre and some cobalt blue. But it's a lighter value. So it's I'm coming back with a darker value later on a lot of these areas. And I want to try to keep the edge on the shoulder soft. So I'm just going warm to cool. Anytime I'm applying any large area of color, I am always thinking, how can I move warm to cool to warm to cool? So this is all the background right now, which again, lighter value than the hair. So it doesn't really matter if I'm going over the hair. You know, I might use a little lavender because I just like it. But I'm using broad, big strokes with a huge brush, which is important. If you start getting really carried away with details, you run the risk of having a very beautiful eye and a crazy looking face. So you don't want to get caught up in doing the fine details. You want to make sure you're focusing on the broad, big shapes. Big, and then we'll subdivide small. I'm going to mute you for a second so I can blow dry and not blow everybody away.
Great. Awesome. Thank you so much for that, Jared, for saving our ears, let's say. And there's this lovely comment in the chat saying, I love how you simply treat your portraits. I've been trying to simplify drawings lately. Yeah, we definitely love how Jared is treating this or breaking this down for us. Sandra, Jared is using 100% cold press arches for some. Yeah. And I think Jared is done.
Okay, yep. Great. Hey. All right. Let's get back into it. I'm going to use a sable brush now. It's not important that you use like a nicer brush. I usually carry synthetics. I like the kind of snap that synthetics have. So I don't want to make it seem like it's, you got to run out and buy an expensive brush. But I do really like the angles and stuff you can get with this. So the next thing we want to do is start thinking about our next step of value. And I'm okay if it's a little damp because I like to have things sort of melt a little bit. Now, if we go cold in the shadows, right, we want to have an element of cool to cool it down. So all flesh is essentially orange with some amount of blue that's that's desaturating it or pushing it towards various other shades. So we want to go from there. So I'm using a yellow ochre because it's already pretty earthy. And then I'm using a fair amount of red because I want to maintain the saturation in the shadow. And then what I might do is just tap it with a little bit of that. This is cobalt blue, or you could use ultramarine. And that will maybe a little bit of carmine. I'm using Daniel Smith paints, if anyone was curious. Usually get that question. So now I just want to start thinking about the way the shadows, the cast shadows, are falling across the person. Now, the first layers of paint we put on, we did about 90% water. We're going about 60% water. You'll notice as I paint, and if you've watched my watercolor demos before, I do a lot of finger painting using my fingers. So I think it's important to do whatever you can to get the marks that you need. So I'm noticing there's a kind of more yellow ochre plane here, and then we're going to get into the more deeper shadow over here. Let's see if we can't use a little coolness to kind of tamp this down in terms of saturation, but I don't want to go too blue, because if you do blue, you're going to end up with a kind of zombie looking figure. And a lot of this we can come back into. So I'm noticing a lot of like reflected light where light is bouncing back up into his eye sockets and forms, but we can always come do that later. This kind of goes down. The eye is in shadow. So I'm closing an eye right now. I'm making a kind of Popeye face. So I look like the cartoon character Popeye.
Which is yeah, that. It does.
Yeah. So I'm closing an eye and squinting. And what that does is that's going to get rid of all of the detail. And I just want to focus on. So I'm noting this is darker than this. So that's the end goal will be to have this darker than that.
All Jared, of this. Just a quick question. Sorry.
Sure. Absolutely. What's that?
I do have a feedback, but what would be the size of this brush that you're using at the moment?
So this is pretty small for what I like to use at working this size, but mm-hmm. This is a 12. Any smaller than that, I only like to use for like the last couple notes and marks. I usually like to use a 16 or an 18. Work big to small, both with brushes and with details. So I because if you go in here with, you know, and you buy a lot of these like kits, when people buy watercolor kits, they'll come with a brush mm-hmm. and the brush is like a zero. It's like a teeny tiny brush. And it drives me nuts because, well, you know, it's kind of funny. Let me say two things about that. It drives me nuts because they'll have these tiny brushes, which to me feel useless, because I've always learned that you paint big brush so you don't do any detail and you work your way to the smaller brushes. But I will say, as I find all of art to be, anytime I'm like, oh, this is, I have a hard rule now for myself and for the future, and I can talk about it. I do want to say I have seen some professional painters. If we're talking about portraits, like Nick Runge, he's a master. He's so good. And he uses a small brush. I was watching him do a demo and I was like, all right, well, I got to quit telling people you have to use a big brush for the whole thing. But all of art is that way. I also would say don't do your dark elements first. And I've seen really great portrait painters do the dark. The very first thing they do is go right in and do the dark of the eye and the darkest dark. So it's kind of funny. Art is a funny thing. So we've got our kind of warm shadow here. I want to try to soften and get a little bit in here for this plane change. And I'm using my finger, and then I wipe the paint off, because you run the risk, and I do this all the time, of picking up paint and just smearing it somewhere else. So we have our basic kind of shadow form here, and I'm finding my kind of connections around. And want to let the recipe loose. We want to remember that the cheekbone is going to go. So we've got forehead, we've got this basic circle kind of thing. And then rolling down to the temple, we're going to roll down the temple. We go out on like a shelf for the top of the zygomatic arch, this cheekbone. It's going to wrap around and then go back down. So remember that we're going to be looking for this plane, this plane, this plane. This plane is facing towards the light source. This is out. Everywhere there's a plane change, there will be a subtle change in color temperature value. So we want to always be aware of that. At this stage, I want to start, well, I'm going to block in the hair and we'll lose all that. But at this stage, I want to start thinking more sculpturally and less, oh boy, I don't know what else you'd be thinking. I've got a little bit of this yellow ochre here, some of my flesh mix, and I'm going to just try to put in a little bit of the indicator of that cheekbone. So we've got temple here, right? Light's catching. If you see on the reference, it gets a little brighter there. We've got the shelf, the bottom of the head, ground on. I don't know why I put that in my mouth, like you could hear me. The bottom of the head grabs on to the top of the head, creating a shelf and a roll of that form. And if they have more muscle in this part of the jaw, you'll get a little bit of light there. But I just want to make sure I'm getting that form and this form. And I want to start thinking about form and planes of form and not so much about the individual parts. It's the same when we're working on, I'm going to go for the hair here. And that will put things in. So we're at the risk, we're running the risk of this thing looking too light. So we need to get some dark in here, because if you keep going like this, you run the risk of your picture looking bleached out. So I said earlier on, we did 90% water. Now you'll see I'm not going back. I don't know if you can see me on the box. Yeah. You'll notice I'm not going back to the water bin anymore. And we're just digging and digging and digging. Ultramarine, burnt umber, and it's getting kind of, you know, thick. And so we want to make sure it's good and thick. We want to go maybe 30% water. And I'm going to vary, there's a little bit of kind of reddish where the light's getting trapped. So you could go real ham-fisted and do red or just yellow ochre. If you take anything away, I hope part of what you'll take away is just getting used to smearing the stuff around, the paint around, and having fun with the willingness to just place, look for these shapes and place these shapes. So we've got, his hair is going to go this way, and it's kind of creates a little bit of a box form there, right? I'm going to cap that off by just, I'm going to mash my brush on the table here. I usually do that on my pants leg or an apron or whatever. And that way we can get these, he's got these kind of loose strands. So I do that for like trees. Maybe I'll smear it with my finger.
Baby hairs.
Yeah. And just get in some of those sort of textural marks. And go back to my puddle of a color. I'll probably reinforce this cast shadow. I'm going to use my fingers to just soften that off. I'm going to switch, throw in some, and again, not going back to the water bucket, just getting thick paint here, using that little bit of paint that was in here, that was in there. And I'm going to just try to block this in. And so it looks really dark, but I did say 30% water. I just added a little bit of water just to keep it moving. But I can still go darker, which I will. You know, maybe it gets lighter there, and I should probably, maybe I'll take a paper towel. I always try to tell students, especially when I was teaching live, at a local art school, do whatever, use paper towel or whatever kind of thing you need to make the marks, the interesting marks that you want. we go down this way. And then we're gonna, I'm gonna bring in some more ultramarine here as it's rolling back and away and get in this area. I want this to be kind of loose, so I'm probably gonna wet this up. I don't really want, we wanna start thinking as well. So we're thinking sculpturally. I'm dragging paint all over here. I'm wanna think sculpturally about the forms, but I also wanna start thinking about my edges. So when we look at people, we tend to focus on the eyes. So I want to make sure that the eyes in this case are gonna be my main actors on the stage, and everything else needs to sort of subordinate. And, you know, if you have a stage play of Romeo and Juliet and they're doing a big dramatic scene, you don't want to have like someone dressed like a tree juggling and opera singing behind them, because it's distracting. So
yeah.
This is my main character, the eyes. Again, let's just loosen the strokes up as we move out. That's my main character, and I want everything else to kind of support that. Just be supportive players. I'm gonna run some. So now on some of those areas, and now I wanna try to bring this, land this plane, so to speak. Now I'm gonna try to go for next to no water. I accidentally hit Payne's Gray. I meant to do Burnt Umber, but Burnt Umber, Ultramarine. And now we're going real thick. Like this would be from the tube, like as dark as it gets. So we can start placing in some of the dark values. So you have, he's got kind of a spot there. And I'm just looking for the shape. Get some of it on the side.
There's this question in the chat saying, is this gouache or watercolor? It's watercolor, and Jared just has like a unique technique on how he makes it look like a gouache painting, if anybody's curious.
This is so, watercolor, yeah. This is absolutely transparent watercolor. I'm going to, so let's get a little warmth in here. And so now we can start subdividing the shapes and look for these smaller shapes that make the rest of it work.
Great. And if you guys are following along, you could actually post your work on our Facebook group. I'm going to be flashing that in the screen. And if you love what you're currently watching, go ahead and let us know through our feedback survey, which I'm also going to be posting in the chat. So imagine how much you're learning right now. You could learn so much more in a 90-minute class.
Yeah, I would, you know, I love talking about this stuff. I mean, I could just stay here doing this all day if you guys have the time on your site. So I always love doing a talking about making art and talking about painting. I'm just looking for how I can subdivide these shapes. We got this shadow here. I'm gonna get real warm red here and get the nostril. You wanna remember that the nostril is gonna be filled with light, and so is the ear. So I wanna go dark and red for the ear, but I also, again, I don't want to make it too specific because I don't want to distract from our main characters. Now, I'm going to go ahead, or well, we need to get in his, let's keep that shadow. This lip is facing downward, so I'm going to get in the form of that. Most of it you don't really see anyways because I'm going to get some burnt sienna here. Actually, some yellow ochre because we got part of it facing the light. So I've got a roughed up brush here. I might even jam it on my desk a little bit to get it a little looser. I want to make sure I don't mess up my little bit of light there because he's got the way his the lip folds over, there's a little bit of light before the pocket here of shadow. And there's a lower plane to this kind of to his mustache here. But I want to keep it all relatively soft and loose. Again, these are my supportive actors. These are not my main characters. I want to like focus on trying to get the eyes to represent. Let's go a little bit. Oops, I nudged. There, sorry. And so I'm gonna just try to rake the texture. I want to just suggest this. I don't want to draw every strand of hair on his face. I just want to suggest, especially down here where it's pretty loose. So just suggesting some hair, but I'm not gonna go in there and try to speckle in any of that texture. We got some darker bits wrapping around the form of the chin. And now we can go ahead and place in the eyebrows and we can sort of start to bring this thing home, so to speak. So I'm always drawing. I'm always trying to think about drawing. So I, even though I've penciled in an area, I still want to kind of keep an eye on the reference, keep an eye on where things are lining up or touching or running against something, and try to make sure you take every opportunity to draw to or to correct your drawing and wraps over that form of the eyebrow. Comes down here, we come in at an angle, and that's where we're going to see the eye. Remember, the eye is a ball in a socket. I should probably switch to a smaller brush, but I really like using big brushes. I actually had this box. I build paint boxes, but I had a friend of mine, Craig Young, custom build this box for me so that I could fit my 2-inch hakes in it, because I love painting with big sloppy. If you can tell, I like a big sloppy paint mess.
Mm-hmm. Just a quick question, Jared. Since you're still in the eye, working with AIs, how will you reclaim or preserve the light in the left eye? Thinking ahead, somebody's asking.
We could go about a couple ways, right? So we could either keep going deeper with the shadow. Maybe my shadow is not deep enough. So we could come back and it's not preferred to have to layer again and do that kind of where you go back over paint. So we could do that is one step. Another step is to take a clean brush. If you're not happy with it, you could take a clean brush, you know, wet the area, take your paper towel. Now mine's soaked. Take a clean paper towel and then rub it against it. So you can see that's part of why I said watercolor is very forgiving. So I could take a clean brush. I could pull some of that back out. What I'm doing though is I'm also trying to constantly group. So I'm trying to constantly think about the fact that I would like to have maybe four. And this is something I'd have to get more into in the 90 minute, but we've got four steps of value: white, very dark, and then some steps between. And I want to take all the value and the complexity of life that's all, you know, infinite seeming. And I want to start pulling them into, so I go, is this darker or lighter? It's closer to this, and start to, you know, we'll say this guy's darker. That didn't make much sense to put them the same, but there. So I want to start trying to group things. Grouping is really the key to the kind of, I think, the mastery of complex art. if we look at great painters, John Singer Sargent, Joaquin Sorolla, to name a couple of the, you know, all-time
heroes, grouping and very strong control of values is a very big part of what they do. They're sort of genius. So I want to make sure that I'm making a decision about where I'm grouping those values. So you're not wrong. There is light there. But to me, I felt like, it's closer to. And so I'm grouping, I'm making the my decision to kind of group it. But I think it's up to the individual. And I think that's why it's important to study masters, because, you know, it's all the information in terms of how to group things and how the masters grouped things. It's all there in what they did. And you can do copies and studies and figure it out and get a little bit more value here. And so, yeah, so, you know, if I wanted to bring that out, I could get a clean brush. I just don't want that eye to distract. I want it to sort of, especially that area, you know? So yeah, so we could bring back some of the light if we wanted to. I'm going to clean that eye up a little more. But so the main goal here, though, with our 30 minutes kind of session here to hang out is that I want to talk. So that this is about how far I might take it if we're sitting in a coffee shop and I'm trying to sketch somebody, you know, anybody who's sketched on location knows people get up and they leave and they move.
Yeah.
And so I want to make sure I'm blocking in the information that's important, and the rest, I'm just going to leave it. You know, you could bring back that clean brush like we talked about, and cause you could really start getting carried away with all of the subtlety of how there's light, there's kind of a rim light to the nose here. You could bring that back or deepen the shadows around it, if that was another way. I guess chess would be a kind of a similar thing where it's always like, we're always, there's a million different ways to do it. So it's all just kind of finding, you know, trying different strategies and figuring out what works best for you. I'm going to bring in some deeper shadow here so that we can try to catch some of that light that's, he's got this sort of rim light that's happening. If you look, so we can just go a little bit further with that. So the light on the nose and go around the nose here.
And while you're doing with the shadows, I think Beth has a quick question about shadow.
Sure,
All right. I have trouble with shadows on a skin. Flesh colors are not obvious to me, and I think I could definitely relate. How do we comprehend shadows with flesh?
Sure. I'm going to try to allow this to dissolve into the shadow there and be fairly loose. So I try to, when it comes to flesh tones, I try to remember my, I try to remember my zones of the face that you catch from sketching people live. And I also try to focus on having a level, just if you can just keep a level of saturation, you'll be in the ballpark of what you're doing. Part of the problem that everybody runs into is that both value and color are relative. And so when you're placing a color and then you place another color, it changes the way you perceive the other color. So it's hard to be laser precise. And there are people who really develop a sense, like a laser precision when it comes to, I mean, like printing out, like if you watch Scott Waddell paint, it's like he prints people. It's very strange. And a lot of that comes from just, he has such a deep scientific understanding of flesh and how light enters through the flesh. Because what we want to remember is we're keeping that saturated because we've got, as opposed to other surfaces, light's going to pass through, zigzag around, and then come out a little bit. So it creates a kind of glow to it. If you can try to keep it warm, you'll be closer in the ballpark than you would be if you're using too many cool colors. But a lot of it too just comes from practice, which I realize is like the least satisfying answer in a class. But it is one of those things that, like, every time you do a sketch or you go to a coffee shop and you sit down and you try to do this, you're just hitting, you know, you're not going to sit down at a piano, well, one would think, and play, you know, the Hungarian Rhapsody or whatever. Yeah. You got to sit down and plink away at the keys, and eventually, so we're coming down. Sorry. Eventually, you know, you get into playing Beethoven and Liszt or whoever, you know. It's a lot of it is like doing these studies, taking classes when you can. A lot of it comes from just life. I did, for me, I got really into life drawing, and I know it's kind of hard now in the world that we're in to just go do life drawing. I used to teach figure painting at an art school, and so that gave me a lot of just, you know, time to just practice and try different things out. And man, I have so many sketchbooks packed with green people, with like just trying everything, and especially as I was developing, because there was a lot of resources, but there was not a lot of subscription schools like there are now. So there's plenty of stuff to learn in terms of places to go in terms of studying and just seeing how people do it. Another thing I suggest too, going back to Sorolla and Sargent, is go study the masters, do copies. I can't reach them now, but across the top, I used to go to the library, which again, I realize is a little bit complicated these days. But I used to go to the library and just collect every single one of the large print versions of artist books. So like all the Andrew Wyeth books that were like 2 feet by 18 inches or whatever, and just fill sketchbooks with copying them. And so if you go study Andrew Wyeth, study more like the ones that weren't as concerned about form and were just concerned about local color and placement. So take people like Manet, you know, go get Manet and compare it to Degas, Cassatt, Sargent, other artists, and do little tiny studies this big. Don't spend too much time like making a big master copy. But I have tons and tons of sketchbooks full of master copies. Currently, like, I'm obsessed with Scott. I'm doing a lot of landscape now because of a book I'm working on, but I'm obsessed with Scott Christensen right now and a couple other artists. And I still do this regularly, which is I just sit and I just go, well, how did they get blue mountains, for example? So how did Manet get flesh tone? And how did he get shadow flesh tone? And just really zoom in and try to match it next to what you're doing and try to replicate the colors they're getting. And you're just filling your own sort of internal database. And then when you're in the field, it will come to you. You'll be more aware. It's that scales on the piano kind of thing where, you know, you'll start being able to put those things together. So I'm a little bothered by the fact that everything has hard edges, even though we're doing a quick sketch and I know we're up against time here. So I'm just going to use a little bit of clean water. You could use a spray bottle. You could use a spray bottle. These are great. Sorry. The Holbein spray bottle, just to spritz an area. For example, maybe you could spritz it and leave it. See if that'll be enough. Or you could spritz it, use a brush, just work it, a clean brush. If you put more water in it, you're going to burn it. But just want to knock away some of these edges. I feel like right now everybody's got their own sort of solo going on, and I want to make sure these people, so to speak, these colors are acting in subordination to the overall idea.
Great. Just to confirm, because it's listed in the description below in the chat, I do hear some feedback.
You do hear feedback?
Yeah, just a little bit, but I think it'll go away just because the mic detects my voice. Yeah, are you using carmine, alizarin crimson, or pyrrole crimson earlier?
So I use carmine. Can you see that far over? This is carmine. I don't have, there are people who get like really into what the chemical science is behind colors. Honestly, I used Cottman box after Cottman box for practice until I felt like I was ready for a professional box. And then I got a professional box. And the first one I got was a Schmincke box, and it came with carmine, and it came with these, with these colors basically. And I just have never switched. I'm a very slow turning ship when it comes to colors. I don't really experiment a lot with different colors. These are 10. I have my 10 that I use. And then for illustration, sometimes I'll use a couple more colors for if it's, especially if it's kid stuff and it's a little more bright, I will, I'll use some brighter colors, but I use the same 10 colors I've used since I started practicing with a box. Alizarin crimson, I find a little bit deeper, might be kind of nice for portraiture, getting places like the nostrils. It's a little more darker, deeper red. I find carmine is a little bit more pink, which I also really like for portraiture, because I find, you know, especially in like noses, a lot of times people have a lot of pink in their flesh. So I personally just, I have used carmine, and so I probably will always use carmine. I know people have take issue with alizarin's fugitive colors or light facetness or some issue people have with it, but I don't really think too much about that, especially when it comes to sketchbook stuff, because a lot of the sketchbook stuff I don't necessarily care if people see it. It's just like I'm just practicing, so whatever keeps you moving. You could try both and see if you like. It just depends. I think alizarin is just a little deeper. You know, if you find you like that, that's great. If you like it a little more saturated, kind of pink, that's what I like. So that's what I've stuck with.
Great. And are you ready to answer a lot of questions? Because we've got a ton of them.
Absolutely.
While you're wrapping up, I know we might be over time, but definitely in a 90 minute class we will be doing more than what we're doing at the moment. So it's 90 minute class, of course, for the newcomers. It's a step-by-step process where you get to learn and expand more of what Jared is talking about at the moment. So imagine what jam-packed information you have at the moment. You'd get to learn more of those in a 90-minute class. So that's going to be, again, on March 11th, 2 p.m. Eastern time. I'm going to be dropping that link soon. And as for the questions, let's go with the most recent one.
Concision. Yeah. I'm not very good with concision. I tend to want to talk about everything. So
No worries.
but I'm happy. Yeah, what's up with the questions? I'm happy to answer any questions.
Great. Ernst Barbaric. Hey Ernst. Thanks for doing this live. I'm curious to know what colors you landed on. Which 10? Have you narrowed down your colors or
my 10? Oh yeah. So this box that has my 10, this is my 10 core that I carry everywhere. This is like my, don't leave home without it in my bag. So I use a bright yellow, which I almost never use, but I keep it because I don't know. I feel like I have to. This is cadmium yellow light. On another box, I have it split. Usually, ideally, you want a warm and a cool of each primary. But I find I use, even though I do a lot of landscape painting, I almost never use bright yellow. Most yellow, even like something bright yellow, because of the way light hits it, is often more yellow ochre. So cadmium yellow light, cadmium red medium. I like cadmium red light, but they don't make it. Daniel Smith doesn't make it. So they have vermilion, but I found that it was too hard to control wrangle. So this is a cadmium red medium, carmine, lavender. I like, this is Daniel Smith's. Holbein also makes a good one. Ultramarine blue. Cobalt blue, which is like a true blue. Ideally, you want something a little further apart, right? So ultramarine has red in the DNA. So I get great purples with it and dull green. So I love it. Cobalt blue is right smack in the middle. ideally you might want to have a cerulean, but I just like cobalt blue. So yellow ochre, burnt sienna and ultramarine make a great black or gray that I always vary from warm to cool. So I always am varying from burnt sienna to ultramarine. Even if it's a gray object, I vary back and forth, back and forth. And then burnt umber, great. It's just a darker version of that, slightly warm. It's a dull, dark orange. So is burnt sienna. Orange and blue are opposites. They make black or gray, dark gray. So if I want a really dark, right? So this area here, then I will use burnt umber for the warmer bit, ultramarine because it's a dark blue. Half and half makes black. And then you can pitch it a little bit of, you know, you want a little bit of burnt umber and you want a little bit of blue. And together they make a dark. And then I keep Payne's gray for value studies. So Payne's gray is great. You can do, I could have done a quick value, you know, like I did here. I could have just kept the white, put a gray in for all the shadows and all that stuff, and then come back with very wet Payne's gray. It's almost black. If I really want dark and I'm in a hurry, then I'll use Payne's gray and burnt umber for black. But I don't use ivory black because it kills the color character of what you're looking at. So I try to always vary from warm to cool to warm to cool. It's almost like a, like, you know, if you're just using black, it's like boiled chicken or boiled food or whatever. It's like, you, why would you miss the opportunity to not season it? So you want to season your colors by constantly varying, like we did in the background here, from warm to cool to warm to cool to warm to cool. You know, the further away you get, I don't want to move stuff or I'm going to mess it up, but the further away you get, the more gray it becomes. The eye sort of merges them. But it's, you know, this variation is better than just that plain, one plain color. You know, there's more color character, which happens in real life. You simulate the way light affects things, because light is always bouncing around. It's absorbing, it's collecting, it's reflecting and hitting other objects and causing different colors. And it's always bouncing back and forth from warm to cool to warm to cool. So I've got white gouache too, by the way, that I keep. And then you can take it. I usually take it straight out of the tube to do stuff if I'm in a hurry, or take it out of the tube and mix it. You know, if you wanted to tamp it down from pure white, you could fix stuff. Like if I goofed up something, I could come back. But I could take some out with a little bit of that yellow to tone it down. You can hit me with the next question if you want. But because that's it for paint pigments, I believe. So like if I want to bring this back, I can come back. You know, maybe I want to bring some of the light back here. Or some of it in the eye.
And I think we could just touch on one final question, and the rest you could actually just raise them to Jared's Instagram.
I'm always happy to talk shop, by the way.
Yeah.
If you want to send a question to me, or you can ask it on my YouTube channel, or I'm sure everything is available, you know, communication list. Email me if you have a lot, that's fine too.
Sure, we'd love that. So plenty of ways to communicate with Jared, but all right, so regarding sketching, I believe, if Jared were doing a caricature, which proportions would he say as are unusual for this subject? So for starters, it looks like he has a shorter nose bridge and a longer upper lip than usual. I think that's a comparison of caricature and portraits. And since we're done, I think we could have your face back so we could see you.
Sure.
And yeah. All right. Go ahead.
Yeah. So the question was about caricature, like how I would
compare both. Yep.
Yeah. So, if I was doing a cartoon person, like I have a structure, like this, the Loomis structure that I, do I have a red pencil? I would just draw right on top of it. I have a loose kind of structure similar to like the, it's a mixture of the Loomis and the Riley methods of drawing, which I'll talk more about in the 90 minute, the structure. And then for cartoons and characters, I'll sort of squash and stretch those things. I'll sort of pull them and play with the proportions to make a taller head. And you do want to be aware of that kind of thing, because the way we see portraits when we're looking at a person is we tend to see things in terms of caricature, which sounds crazy, but just like our eye literally in periphery sees a caricature of the person that we know. And that's part of why we know when we're looking at someone that we, let me allow there. Hi. So when we're looking at someone that we know, the part of the reason we know them so quickly is because our brain does this weird little, like, you know, caricature where they're, if they have a prominent nose, the nose becomes bigger. If they have prominent ears, their ears become bigger. And we go, oh, that's, you know, Hazel or whoever. That's our friend, is we recognize those caricaturized. So when you're doing a portrait, it's a weird balance that you have to study over time, and don't get in your head thinking about it, because you can drive yourself nuts. But we do want to kind of play with those notes, in that if they have a prominent nose, we want to make sure that that is part of what's visible, because painting a person to make them recognizable as that person, you want to be aware of those notes, because that's part of, so same with the way the light affects the person, because we see things in value very clearly and crisply, we want to just be aware of those relationships.
Okay, so for the rest of the questions, I think we could reserve them to, as Jared has mentioned, Instagram. Could reach him via email or via his YouTube account. Or Jared might need to backtrack through this chat to address most of your questions. And yeah, you could maybe we could share some stories maybe to answer most of these questions. That would be interesting. Okay, great. So that was a lovely preview of the 90-minute class. Again, that was jam-packed with information, and imagine how much you could learn more in his 90-minute class. All right, so I think we're going to wrap up. All right, everybody, Etchr does these live demos a couple of times a week, so make sure you hit that subscribe button below for Jared's YouTube if you loved his content. You might want to see more of those. And if you want to see more of these live sessions on Etchr, I'm going to be dropping Etchr's YouTube, so you could go ahead and hit subscribe there. And if you like today's demo, please click the like button below to show some love for Jared. And let us know how we did today through our feedback survey, which I'm going to be dropping link right here. So if you loved the content, if you loved how Jared explained things, go ahead and let us know. If you want Jared to do more of these in the future, let us know as well.
Happy to.
And also, great. And also, Etchr has a Make More Art podcast. So if you want to listen to some of our featured artists while you paint, go ahead and listen to our podcast. And as I don't think I've mentioned this in the beginning, but if you are a first time Etchr Lab customer, you get to receive a 10% discount using the code TRY10 at your checkout. I'm going to be dropping that link in the chat if you're interested. All right, Jared, any final thoughts before we sadly have to close the session? But maybe you could grab the 90-minute class and talk about it a little bit for the newcomers.
So here is the I don't know if the lighting is very good, but this is my lovely wife again. So this was really fun, by the way. Thank you so much for watching, and I'm thrilled to look at the questions and go through them. I love talking about this stuff, so I can't wait. I do have some other portrait demos and stuff. A lot of what I do on my YouTube channel is landscape, just because I just kind of go with the flow of what the most questions are, and I get a lot of questions about gouache and landscape. So a lot of what my channel is gouache or watercolor and landscape. But I love talking about portraits. It's one of my favorite things to do on location, you know, Christmas get together. I love posting up in the corner and just doing portrait sketches. It's a whole universe of information and stuff to study, and it's endless, and you're never, you know, I feel like there's always room to grow. There's always, I still watch people do demos and I go, oh my gosh, I never thought of that. That never occurred to me. And so I love that about portraits. So that was really fun doing the quick version. And then in the 90-minute version, we're going to get more into the complexity of those forms. So I tried to touch on it a little bit, but that sort of combination of the Riley method and the Loomis method of constructing the head, I don't spend a ton of time on building the structure. I think it's important to do those scales on the piano, so to speak. I don't spend a lot of time on it because I find when the person starts to turn their head, if you're at a coffee shop and they're constantly turning, it all goes out the window and it's super frustrating. So I find it's best to just get used to trying to hit your points, go broad, simple, light, and then subdivide into the smaller shapes until you get that where you want it. And even then, when you're painting, we'll talk more in the 90 minute about correcting the painting as you go. You know, maybe you get this far and the jaw, you know, they don't quite look right. Look away and you look back and you go, oh, their jaw is too big or their nose is too high. Well, we can fix that. You can always fix it. So we can always go back and fix it, even if it's watercolor, without, you know, totally throwing the sketch away. So we'll talk more about that, finding the placement of forms, and then a lot about the what I am really interested in, which is the sculptural facets of the human head. So like what we said with building the cheekbone, that's happening everywhere. There's all these little kind of complex things that happen over and over again in portraiture. And I love to talk about those planes and then how we handle those planes as light hits that object. So figuring out that local color, finding a patch of a color, and then using our knowledge of planes to move across. Are we moving towards the light source, away from the light source? Is it getting warmer, cooler? How can we make those calculations in our mind and place a color that builds form, builds with a awareness of light.
Great.
Did I put you to sleep? Sorry. I'm not good with concision. I tend to just prattle on.
No, I think everybody right here is giving such nice comments about you, your work, and how great you are at explaining things. Just like the most recent one, that was an awesome tip about grouping values. Morgan says they've been super active in plugging your Patreon as well. People are super lovely.
That's where my full demos are. I do the full demos there, and then my YouTube channel is the like sped up version of the demos.
Great. All right. So thank you so much, everybody. And thank you so much, Jared, for that wonderful preview. Hope to see you guys in his 90-minute class. And again, thank you, everybody, as well, for being so enthusiastic in the chat. You've been super amazing audience. And until next time, make more art, everybody. Bye for now.
Thanks.
Jared, you might want to switch the camera.
Which one do I switch to?
The workspace. Awesome. Thank you so much. Bye, guys.